جئنا إلى الدنيا كي ندعو إلى الله لننشر الخير في الكون الذي حار. الله 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 أكبر.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله وحده، والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده، أما بعد. اللهم ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأتباعه وأزواجه وذرياته. Alhamdulillah, we are here today to initiate the introduction to studying the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is such a blessed occasion and gathering wherein there are many, many virtues which inshallah we will discuss today. And hopefully after today's first lesson, you could say, we will be going back with a lot of important information in regards to the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as well as the etiquettes and the spirituality in regards to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's ahadith. Now, something which is very, very important for us to understand, before we undertake any activity in regards to Islam, it is very, very important that we learn and understand the usul, the principles and the adab and the etiquettes of that activity that is going to be undertaken. For example, a person, he wants to perform salah. Now, if he's going to perform salah, he has to make sure that the do's and don'ts are fulfilled. And at the same time, he fulfills the etiquettes and the principles of that salah, so that that salah is accepted in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why in a hadith which has been mentioned by Imam Bukhari rahimahullah, where upon occasion the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was traveling with the Sahaba, and they reached a point where some companions decided to go forward and other companions were slightly behind. So as those companions who went forward managed to reach a location to perform wudu, many of them performed wudu, but they did it in a very swift and quick manner. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam approached, because there was a lot of heat and it was a hot day, the shins and the feet and ankles of some companions began to shine in the light and in the heat. And when it is a hot season, when a person washes his body, some parts you can recognize that this part has been washed, and other parts you can see that this has been left dry. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw the companions and he said, "Waylu lil aqabi minan nar." Now these companions are going to pray salah behind who? The greatest man who has stepped foot on the face of the earth. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching them a lesson indirectly. And what is that? That if your salah, if your wudu is not correct, then your salah will never be correct. And if your salah is not correct, then you are never going to get closeness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And why was it? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw that some of their ankles and the back area of their feet was left dry. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Waylu lil aqabi minan nar." Destruction for those ankles. And in another narration, the meaning of waylun means that the valley of Jahannam is destined for those individuals who do not wash their feet in wudu when performing their wudu. So very, very important that we learn the dawabit and the usul in regards to any activity that takes place. What is the one reason behind this? Once we learn the activity and the usul and the principles of that activity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through His mercy will accept that amal which we are doing for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in regards to hadith, the ulama mentioned, and mainly my respected sheikh and teacher, Sheikh Salim Dorat Sahib Hafidhahullah, he has written a book in regards to the adab of hadith. Very beautiful book. Those who get the chance, inshallah, should purchase the book and read in regards to what he has written. A few points which he has mentioned. Number one, he says that a person, what are the benefits of adhering to the dawabit and the usul in regards to learning the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Number one, what is the benefit that you gain? Number one, he said, the help and assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala arrives for that person. When you act upon the ahadith according to the principles and adab, the first blessing that you get is you will be showered with the assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what we need in this current day and age, where Muslims are suffering, where we are going through a lot of difficulties. If we act upon the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, bring those principles and those etiquettes into our lives, inshallah, we will be assisted in our day-to-day activities which we go through on a daily basis. Number two, he mentions that seeking ilm, the knowledge of ahadith, what is the benefit of that? The second point he mentions, that when you learn and act upon those etiquettes and those principles, learning that knowledge which you are trying to achieve becomes a means of success in this dunya and in the akhirah. And this is what a Muslim wants, desire, that I become successful in this dunya and I become successful in the hereafter. Number three, he mentions that when you act upon the principles and the etiquettes of that adab of ahadith, what is the blessing? That you will see the efforts of this knowledge that you are learning inside your life. Nowadays people, and this is a reality, we find so many Muslims who have so much information in regards to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but when you mirror that to their a'mal, to their actions, they are very far from this. And you look at them and you feel sorry for that person, that he knows so much, but that knowledge is not beneficial and fruitful for him inside his life. One of the reasons is because there is no principles that are being followed, there are no adab inside the knowledge which he has learned. And this is why he's being deprived of acting upon that ilm which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed him. And the fourth reason he mentions, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not only enable you to bring that ilm into your life, but he will enable you to teach other people the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, Allah will baptize you according to how he wants you to be. And through that, you will also teach other people around you. And you will be a da'i. You will be a one who calls other people towards the religion of Islam through the a'mal and through the ilm that you have learnt. Now, he further mentions that there are three etiquettes which are connected to the spirituality of ahadith. You know, again, like I mentioned, in the day and age which we live in, you find many, many people carrying out courses, many, many different activities that are taking place, but there is no spirituality inside those activities. And that is why they go, they arrive at that course, they leave, they are the same person as they were for the 10 years that they've been performing that course, or for the 10 days that they have been performing that course. Why? Because they do not understand the spirituality aspect of that amal which they are doing. There is a lot of importance in regards to the spirituality of the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is why they mention Imam Malik rahimahullah, how much adab and respect he had for the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Upon occasion he was teaching, Abdullah bin Mubarak rahimahullah mentioned this, that he was teaching ahadith, and whilst he was teaching, he got stung by a scorpion 16 times on his body. And he says, we saw that he was agitated, frustrated, but he didn't move from his position. And after the lesson, the lecture, I said to my teacher, Imam Malik rahimahullah, that what happened to you? I saw your color change on your face and your body was feeling agitated. I could see the effects of this on your body. And he said, why didn't you move and why didn't you get up from your majlis, your gathering? He said, the only reason why I didn't get up was out of respect for the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when you have people like this, then they deserve to be buried in Jannatul Baqi. They are deserving of being next to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? Because of the adab and respect they have in regards to the ahadith. My Shaykh, he mentioned the teacher, he says that the number one etiquette connected to spirituality is you have to have azma. You have to have the aspect in your life where you actually believe that there is nothing more greater than the sayings of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is nothing more greater. Not because I am saying, but because it is connected to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His words, his speech, his eating, his sleeping, every single action by Allah. Even the Messenger of Allah eating with his fingers. This is a amal and sunnah so great that nothing in the dunya can compare to that amal. We have to have that azma, we have to have that respect, reverence for this sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for the ahadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number two, we have to have love for this ilm. You know, the difference between reverence and love, people claim we live in a society, everybody, Ashiqe Rasool, Ashiqe Rasool. But when you look at him, brother doesn't even wake up for Fajr Salah, he's Ashiqe Bed. He doesn't want to get out of his bed, unfortunately. And he says that I have love for the Messenger of Allah. True love, according to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is that love which forces you and compels you to do what your beloved has told you to do. Otherwise, it is just lip service. So reverence is respect. You know, respect. Like just a friend, mashallah, we have brother Shazadi as well, Maulana Adam from Jewsbury, good friend of mine. He had a clip up on his WhatsApp. Unfortunate that the charity shop Umma Welfare Trust, there was some people who've actually left literature outside of the shop in the morning, and when he went to pick it up, it was actually the Quran-i-Kareem. You know, somebody just left it on the floor. This is out of, and unfortunately, our people, what did they do? They left their checkbooks, which date back all the way to 1989. They left that there as well. You know, if you don't have azma and you don't have reverence for the Quran and for the ahadith, then it doesn't matter how great of a Muslim you are, in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will be rejected. And you will be questioned in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So second point, we have to have love for this ilm. Reverence and love. These are two necessary points in regards to the teachings, the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number three, what do we have to have? Which is the most important thing, that is the correct intention. Correct intention. Why am I here? Okay, I'm going to come to the durus, connected to Riyadhus Salihin. Why? Because I'm going to start debating with my friend in college. I'm going to start debating with my work colleague who works with me. He's from a different sect. I'm going to throw these ahadith, na'uzu billah, in front of him, and I'm going to have a debate with him. We will understand. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man ta'allama ilman mimma yubtagha bihi 'azza wa jalla la yata'allamuhu illa liyusiba bihi 'aradan min ad-dunya." The one who seeks the knowledge, deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for other than the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he seeks it to seek the dunya, then what is going to happen? Lam yajid 'araf al-jannah yawm al-qiyamah. He will not even smell the fragrance of Jannah on the day of judgment. He will not smell the fragrance on the day of judgment. So our intention has to be correct. Okay, I'm learning the hadith. Why? I'm learning it, number one, so I can gain close proximity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is my intention. And number two, I will learn the ahadith and I will try my best to bring amal and action and practice upon that hadith which I have learned on that day. No other intention. And the reason why the ulama mentioned, he will not smell the fragrance of Jannah, you know why? Because the dunya in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not even equal to the wing of a mosquito. And you know, if it's not equal to the wing of a mosquito in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that person goes out so he can gain some of the dunya, then this person will be deprived of smelling the fragrance of Jannah. And the ulama mentioned, the fragrance of a Jannah, how far can you have smell the fragrance? A distance of 40 years, the fragrance of Jannah can be smelled. But these people will be deprived. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from being amongst these individuals. Ameen. Now, very quickly, I don't want to take too much time, inshallah. The goals and objectives of studying hadith. Number one, the first reason we study ahadith, like I mentioned before, the intention has to be correct, but the number one intention should be that we are studying the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for all those reasons in regards to which the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned about his words and statements. What did the Messenger of Allah mention? A very beautiful hadith. He said, نَضَّرَ اللَّهُ إِمْرَعًا سَمِعَ مَقَالَتِي فَحَفِظَهَا فَأَدَّاهَا كَمَا سَمِيَهَا أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ. He said, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blossom. May Allah keep that person's face radiant. May he shine in the dunya and akhirah. Who hears my statements and then he memorizes them and he passes on that statement or that hadith onto other people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep him happy in the dunya and in the akhirah. That is why the muhaddithin, they mentioned that a person who connects himself to a hadith, one interpretation they have given, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses and puts nur on that person's face. مَا كَانَ مِنْ رَجُلٍ إِلَّا كَانَ عَلَى وَجْهِهِ نَضْرَةٌ. That مَا مِنْ رَجُلٍ يَطْلُبُ الْحَدِيثِ إِلَّا كَانَ فِي وَجْهِهِ نَضْرَةٌ. That there's not a single person who seeks hadith and learns the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses him with a special nur on his face. And not everybody can see it, only the Ahlul Basira, the people of farsightedness, can see that nur on that person's face. So the first intention should be that we are going to learn these ahadiths for all those reasons which the Messenger of Allah mentioned. And one of them is that may Allah keep, you know, we want to get part of the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah keep that person blessed in the dunya and in the akhirah who learns my ahadith and passes it on to other people. There's two interpretations of this hadith. One is the ulama mentioned that this is a dua from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, meaning the Messenger of Allah made dua for all those muhaddithin and those who learn ahadith, that may Allah keep him happy, blessed in the dunya. May Allah make him radiant in the dunya and in the akhirah. This is a dua from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And another interpretation of this is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is a statement from the Messenger of Allah, that may Allah is going to do this with such and such a person. Meaning the Messenger of Allah is informing us that whoever involves himself in ahadith, learning and passing on, learning and propagating, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will keep him, his face radiant in the dunya, and he will be radiant in the akhirah as well. What more can we ask for when the Messenger of Allah is making dua? And let me explain something very beautiful. When the Messenger of Allah makes dua for people like me and you, when we will involve ourselves in ahadith, you know the effect of dua. Anas bin Malik radiallahu an, he mentions, I was with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He spent 10 years doing the service of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. 10 years, a long time. He says, I was with the Messenger of Allah, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was present, and my auntie was present, and my mother was present, and the Messenger of Allah performed a voluntary prayer, Nafl Salah. And after praying Nafl Salah, he made dua for me, and for my mother, and for my auntie. And the Messenger of Allah was presented by my mother in front of the Messenger of Allah. I was presented, and my mother said, Khuwaidumuka, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, this is your small servant. Please accept him for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says, Anas radiallahu anhu says, the Messenger of Allah made three du'as. He said, Allahumma akthir ma'lahu, may O Allah increase him in his wealth. Wa barik lahu fi waladihi, O kama qal, O Allah bless him in his children. Wa ghafir lahu, O Allah forgive him in the hereafter. Anas radiallahu anhu says, the du'a was so immense in my life and so intense that everybody's crops and produce would yield once a year. And the dua of the Messenger of Allah was such that my crops would yield twice a year. Twice a year. And then he says that with my own blessed hands, the Messenger of Allah's dua was so powerful that with my own hands, I buried over 80 grandchildren with my own hands. And they mention he lived for over 100 years. And Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu used to say, I've seen the first two parts of the dua inside this dunya that Allah has accepted it. And I have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the dua which the Messenger of Allah said, oh Allah, forgive him. I have hope when I meet Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, oh Anas, I have forgiven you of all your sins as well. So if this is the dua that Anas radiallahu anhu received from the Messenger of Allah, imagine the impact that this dua will have. When we learn and propagate the ahadith of the Messenger of Allah, imagine how much effect this will have in our lives as well. So number one, our intention should be that all those du'as and all those blessed statements the Messenger of Allah mentioned in regards to the ahadith, we try to bring those into our lives and we try to include ourselves inside those du'as. I mentioned another hadith and narration. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, upon occasion, he came out to the companions. Imam Khatib Baghdadi rahimahullah mentioned this in his book, Sharafu Ahli al-Hadith, the nobility or the honor that the people of hadith receive from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He mentioned that there is a narration where the Messenger of Allah came out to the companions and he said, Allahumma arham khulafai, O Allah, have mercy on my successors. And the Sahaba asked, O Messenger of Allah, Man khulafa'uk, who are your successors? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Alladhina ya'tuna min ba'di, those who come after me, wa yarhuna ahadithi wa sunnati wa yu'allimuna hannas, they are those people who will come after me, they will learn my sunnah, they will learn my ahadith, and they will teach it to the people and to the masses. May Allah have mercy on them. They are my successors. Nowadays, what happens? Somebody is connected with a sheikh who has 1.4 million followers on Twitter. And what do you say? I know him. He came to my house for a cup of tea. I've got 1.4 million subscribers. I'm also subscribed to the sheikh. He came to my house last week. Who is my sheikh? That is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is saying, I am his successor. And he is pleased with me being the successor after him. Why? Because we are going to study and learn the ahadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is no more greater virtue than these two ahadith which I mentioned. Number two, point number two. What we need to keep in mind is the goal and objective of hadith is that when we learn the ahadith, then number two point is that when we learn ahadith, we will be the most closest of people to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the Day of Judgment. Why is that? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Awla an-nasi bi yawm al-qiyamati aktharuhum alayya salatan." The closest of people to me on the Day of Judgment are those who send the most salutations upon me, who send durood, who send salat and salam upon me in the dunya. Now try to understand this. We are people, 1,441 years have passed by since the demise of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or since the calendar, Islamic calendar was made. Now, we are 1,400 years away from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Every single one of us sitting here wishes that he tries to be as close as possible to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There's only one way. And as far as we get from the Messenger of Allah in regards to the dunyavi aspect, the closer we can get is through spirituality, and that is
by reading salat and salam upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So those people who come the furthest, near the end of times. So let's have an example. Somebody arrives just before the descent of Isa alayhi salam, or Dajjal arrives. He recites salat and salam in abundance. He will, despite him being so far from the Messenger of Allah in the dunya, he will be the most closest to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the akhirah. There's no better bargain that you get in this dunya, that you recite durood and you will be the closest to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is why Imam Ibn Hibban rahimahullah, he mentions, he says, the reason why the people who are the muhaddithin and those who learn and understand the ahadith will be closest to the Messenger of Allah is because they are the ones who recite the most durood in abundance. Imagine somebody teaches, like we have these Darul Ulooms in England, a Shaykhul Hadith, he teaches for 5 hours, and in those 5 hours, just in 1 hour, on one hadith, how many times does he repeat sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Each time he recites sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one step closer he gets to closer to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the more we recite durood in these gatherings, and when the teacher, or when we recite a hadith, we say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are getting more closer to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is the second objective. And the third objective, Shaykhul Hadith, Mawlana Muhammad Zakariya rahimahullah, he mentions, and you know, for people to truly understand who this man was, you know, he came a couple of hundred years ago, possibly, can't remember the exact date, but he came a couple of hundred years ago, and this man, where is he buried? He's buried in Jannatul Baqi. And what does he mention? Sheikh Zakariya rahmatullah alayhi says, forget the first two points, what I just mentioned, that you recite durood in abundance, that is the objective of learning hadith. Number one was that you be included inside those du'as of the Messenger of Allah. He said, leave them aside. He said, if there was only one reason to read ahadith and study ahadith, then what is that one reason? He said that one reason should be that the Messenger of Allah is beloved to every believer, male and female. And because he is our beloved, he is our mahbub, this love demands that we talk and mention as much as possible about the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is a objective in itself. And he mentions the saying of the ulama who say that man ahabba shay'an akthara dhikrahu. Whoever loves something, then he makes mention of that as much as possible. So we love the Messenger of Allah, we have to make mention of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as much as possible, as long as we are studying the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the fourth point is, just finishing off very quickly, the fourth point is that the last objective should be that when we study ahadith, and this is a very, very important point as well, when we study ahadith, what are we doing? We are rubbing on, or we are baptizing ourselves into the color of the companions radiyallahu anhum. Why? Because when we're studying ahadith, what are we doing? We are sitting in the company of the companions and in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what happens through this? We are developing inside us the characteristics of the sahaba radiyallahu anhum. And through this, we are going to become more closer to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is why the ulama mentioned a couplet in the Arabic language, which has been mentioned by Sheikh Salim as well. He says, "Ahlul hadithi hum ahlul nabi, wa illam yashabu nafsahu anfasahu sahibu." That the people, those who are occupied in ahadith, in learning and teaching ahadith, these people, they are what? Ahlul nabi. They are the people of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what does he say? وَإِلَّمْ يَسْحَبُوا نَفْسَهُ. Even though they have not physically accompanied the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this because of the period, the gap between the Messenger of Allah and these people. But what has actually accompanied the Messenger of Allah? It is the speech and the sayings and the statements of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when we recite, learn, and understand ahadith, even though physically we are not with the Messenger of Allah, spiritually and by the words which we are mentioning, we are very, very close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the fourth point should be, objective should be, that we are learning ahadith, studying ahadith. Why? With the objective and goal that we are trying to build inside us the characteristics of the companions radiyallahu anhum. And the companions will be with the Messenger of Allah. When we learn and study the akhlaq and the mannerisms of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who passed it on to the companions, then in the day of judgment we will also be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is why Abdullah bin Mubarak rahimahullah, he mentions, he says that upon occasion somebody came to him and said, "Sheikh, you know, you sit at home all day and you know you're boring, you don't come out, you're like a loner. Why do you sit at home all day? Nobody sees you outside on the streets. You're always locked up in your room." So Abdullah bin Mubarak rahimahullah, he said, a very beautiful point. He said, "Who said that I am alone?" He said, "When I pick open the seerah and when I learn and look at the books of ahadith, the Messenger of Allah is in the Battle of Badr, I am also in the Battle of Badr with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Messenger of Allah is in the Battle of Uhud and he was bleeding and he was going through difficulty, I was also with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? Because when I am reading that book and when I am studying the ahadith, then I am also accompanying the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in every single aspect of his life. Who said I am alone? Who said I am alone? So when we are in this gathering, spiritually we are with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So these are four points which we need to keep in mind. And just finishing up very quickly, I want to mention what is the virtues of coming to study a hadith. You know, we, like I said, mentioned before, unfortunately, we live in a day and age, everybody wants to learn off social media. Even though one aspect, it's okay to refresh, and you know, you might have missed a lesson, and you go over that, alhamdulillah. But unfortunately, people have taken social media to such a level, YouTube and Facebook and all these things, what have they? They've actually taken these as masajid. So what they do is sit at home and they learn the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you don't find them inside the masjid, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to come to the masjid to learn the deen of Allah. And I can guarantee you one thing, my friends, that when you come to the masjid, you might even learn 1% of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That will bring amal inside your life compared to the hours and hours that you spend on Facebook or YouTube trying to learn the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why is that? Because this place is beloved to the Prophet, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu, the Messenger of Allah said, "Ahabul biladi ilallahi masajiduha." The most beloved of places to Allah is the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if this place is beloved to Allah, Allah is sending out spirituality through these places. And what is part of that spirituality? When we learn inside the house of Allah, we will see that we are given the tawfiq and ability to bring amal and action inside our life as well. One last narration I want to mention, Abu Dharr radiallahu an, he mentions, which has been mentioned by Imam Ibn Majah, in his book of hadith, he mentions that Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu upon occasion was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There's many ahadith in regards to the virtues of going out as a student of knowledge, but this one narration I want to share with you. He says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ya Abu Dharr, O Abu Dharr, la an taghduwa fata'allama ayatan min kitabillah khairul laka min an tusalliya mi'ata raka'atin." O Abu Dharr, for you to go out in the morning and to learn one verse from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how good is it for you? It is better for you. It is far better for you that you perform 100 rakat nafal salah. Imagine, one verse of the book of Allah, it is better for you that you perform than performing 100 nafal rakat. And then he mentioned, the Messenger of Allah said, that وَلَا أَن تَغْدُوَ فَتَعَلَّمَ بَابًا مِنَ الْعِلْمِ أُمِلَ بِهِ أَوْ لَمْ يُعْمَلْ. He said, for you to leave in the morning and to go and learn one chapter of knowledge, one chapter of knowledge, even if you act upon it or you don't act upon it. And the reason why the Messenger of Allah mentioned this is because sometimes when we learn knowledge, it is not connected to amal, it is connected to aqaid, aqidah, belief. So you memorize and understand, so there's no need for you to actually physically act upon that knowledge. So the Messenger of Allah said, whether you act upon it or not, if it's connected to aqaid, beliefs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. So you know in your mind that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. There is nothing like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is nothing to do with amal. It is knowledge, information that you need to know. So whether you act upon it or not, going out in the path of Allah, learning one chapter of knowledge, how good is it for you? He said, "Khairul laka min an tusalliya alfa raka'at." It is better for you, even for you, that you perform 1,000 nafal optional prayers. So learning one chapter of knowledge and performing 1,000 rakat, then that chapter of knowledge is far greater for you than performing 1,000 nafal rakat. Why? That nafal rakat will only be beneficial for you. And that one chapter of knowledge, and it's possible, you're praying 1,000 nafal rakat, that 1,000 nafal rakat of yours is full of riyah and showing off. And you went out and you went and learned one chapter of knowledge which was connected to riyah, showing off, and you learned that you should not show off, that is better for you. Why? Because you will understand and learn that now I need to pray 1,000 rakat without showing off. And now I need to do this amal and I need to do this. So this is a virtue. And one more hadith which the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. He said, "Man kharaja fi talab al-ilm fahuwa fi sabilillahi hatta yarji." Whoever goes out in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to seek knowledge, he is in the path of Allah until he returns home. Many people think that I go to a darulum, spend 6 years, 10 years studying, only then I become a talibul ilm. No, that is wrong. If you leave your house on a Thursday with the intention that I am going to sit in the dars of hadith, that I want to be a student of knowledge, then you will also be included inside this hadith. So many people think that I have to go to a darloom to become a hafiz, or I have to have this intention. Many people are out there who go and perform hajj and umrah. Their intention is not accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Amal is there, but the intention is wrong. But there are so many people who do something small, like coming Thursday and sitting in the durus and learning something in regards to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is far greater than those people who go out in the path of Allah to go and perform hajj and umrah. Why? Because the niyyah and intention is correct. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the ability and tawfiq to bring these points into our lives, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make these gatherings that we will have inshallah beneficial for us in this dunya and in the akhirah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ikhlas in whatever we are doing at the moment. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reunite us together like this in Jannatul Firdaus with the companions and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ameen wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alameen wa sallallahu ta'ala ala khairi halki Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.